Point in our discussion where we have been discussing now for 2 days. I think people have thought about a lot of different connections that we can make in Ukrainian modernism, and now it falls to my colleague John Malmstad to try to bring some shape and form to this, or at least to give us some possible directions to go. So I'm very, very pleased.
Do you have that all written
that
down?
We have
no.
Him
will that be
to give us some closing remarks.
You know, I really
I shall be very brief. Over the time.
The thing is,
I want to say is, I hope we'll be taken not in any confrontational manner, but quite in the opposite, to suggest maybe a nuance and to suggest some synthesis of some of these very interesting questions, which have come to the fore in this over these day and a half. And I want to go back, if I may, to Miroslava's paper, not to comment on it again, but to something that she raised in her paper, namely the World of Art movement, which had, of course, a distinguished Ukrainian member, namely Narbut. This movement, the World of Art, I think has been traditionally undervalued in discussions of Russian art, dismissed as a kind of Petersburg stylization movement with of no particular value, except that it did produce the Ballet Russe, which was, of course, one of the most astonishing cultural enterprises of the first three decades of this century. I think the World of Art, on the contrary, was the essential stage for the emergence of the avant-garde and in the Russian Empire, and that without it, it might have had to wait for quite a few decades more before it did emerge. And I think that because I want to talk about it not as a stylistic movement, but as an ideological movement, the ideology of the World of Art. And it's from the very first issue of the journal, from the very first exhibitions, they did something entirely radical in the Russian context. And permit me to talk about this as a Russian context at the moment. One was the first big exhibit was to show Russian and Finnish art, the art of a province of the empire, together, never been done before. This was perceived by many Russian critics as a terribly radical and unnational thing to have done. And their proclaimed goal was to, in their words, and this may be fair or not fair, I think it is fair, was to deprovincialize Russian art. They believed Russian art had become backward, was in a state of decline, and had cut itself off from sources which had always made Russian art more truly Russian, namely Europe. That for too many decades, Russians had held themselves away from contact with the West, as though this how someone would contaminate Russian art. The World of Art painters, people like Stravinsky, the important musicians, and of course figures in the other arts, the ballet, etc., believe this was quite the opposite was true. And read any of the statements of Diaghilev, Stravinsky's autobiography, writings of Fokine and ballet, etc., the insistence that Russian art became truly national in spirit when it was in contact with the West. This is a terribly important dimension of the World of Art, which we then see become a part of the ideology of the avant-garde. Let me make a big jump, and they recognize this, them themselves, at their exhibitions. They were the first, for example, to champion one of the most interesting, and I'm not saying great, but certainly one of the most fascinating paintings to my mind of the first decade of the century, Trilionis, a Lithuanian painter. The people who championed him, who bought his works in major, were the members of the World of Art. They were the ones who did this. I mean, there was nothing narrowly Petersburgian even about them, nationalists. They were international in scope. And this dimension, I think, is terribly important for the emergence of the avant-garde. And let me jump to 1914, what must have been an extraordinary one-woman show. Some 400 works were shown in Moscow and then Petersburg by Gonchurova. And there's a fascinating brief catalog statement that she made in which she said something which I believe really informs a lot of what we've been talking about. That here, and the for the avant-garde, and I'm talking now about the pictorial dimension of the avant-garde, and that was when she said that awareness of what was going on in Western European art, she obviously meant having the great collections of models of Shukin, et cetera, her exposure not only to Impressionist but primarily to post-Impressionist art, had opened her eyes to what was going on, to the art of her own country. That this had been the shock which suddenly opened her eyes, and I think opened the eyes of many people, to the art of the peasants, to urban art, that is folk art in the cities, culture, Lubki, the famous street signs, etc., toys, etc. She then went on, however, to make an even very radical statement when she, having said this, thanked her French counterparts, if you like, for having opened her eyes, to assert the nationality of her own art and the art of the avant-garde, to say, we are the East, we're not the West, we are Asia, etc. This is another huge theme which could be gone into. In other words, in one statement, there is an insistence on the international quality of her art and the national quality. And this, I think, becomes very, very characteristic of the emerging avant-garde in general. Certainly, neo-primitivism was the first important movement in the avant-garde. Gonchourova, Larionov were the primary inspirers, if you like, of this. Another dimension of that statement, which has always struck me as extremely interesting, is the emphasis on the problem of identity. And the assertion on Gonchourova's part of a new definition of Russian. She's talking about Russia. We're still talking about Russia, alas. I will get to the connection. Is her concern about matters of identity and her assertion of another kind of identity. Russians had always been battling, are we this, are we the East or West, are we in something in between, and coming down firmly on the side, we are barbarians, we are Diki, we are Asia, etc. Something which, again, was horrifying for many people. What is interesting about this, I think, is that this problem of identity, who are we in this period, is characteristic not only of Russians, but of all other members of this multinational empire. They're all asking this question, and Ukrainians are asking it at the same time that the Russians are. I had originally hoped we might call this conference Modernisms or Modernism in Ukraine, and I thought we would have gotten us around this very sticky problem of what is Russian, what is Ukrainian modernism, because if I've been working on this for over 40 years, I wouldn't have a clue. I wouldn't know where to begin if someone said, define Russian modernism. I can't do it. I can talk about what are modernisms, what forms modernism takes, stylistically, in other ways, on the territory of Russia, in Ukraine, in other parts of the empire in this period. To define it, I can't do it. What I do want to say, though, and I hope this will be taken in the spirit in which I intend it, is I think that Ukrainian, let's use the term, Ukrainian modernism and Russian modernism have a great deal in common in this period. We need not see them as somehow coming at themselves in that fashion. They share concerns with what is identity, what is national, what is international, what is universal. They share styles in a way that Russian and Ukrainian art share with no other art. Where you will look in vain outside the territory of Ukraine and Russia for anything called cubofuturism. It doesn't exist in Polish art, it doesn't exist in Czech art. Czech has great futurist painters, but it doesn't have cubofuturism. The two countries, the two modernisms, if you like, share that as they share symbolism, neoprimitivism, constructivism, etc. So that I think as research goes on, I certainly intend to do that in my own work, that we keep this in mind, this shared concern, and not try to say it's only this or it's only that. And at the same time, that we look at another dimension, and that is not to insist on the national alone. Certainly, I would not deny in any way that these movements in painting that I've just mentioned, took on national characteristics in their individual conflict, in Russia as opposed to Ukraine. Undeniably so. They, in other words, they share, I think, a common origin. And as individual painters developed them, worked on them, they inevitably assume not only personal styles, personal elements, but national elements as well. I think it's perfectly proper for us to discuss that. However, it is this complicated relationship between the national and the supranational, which I think is so interesting about this period. And that's why I would hope we don't try, as a very good book by a late friend of many of us, Evgeny Kaftun, a wonderful book on street signs, in which suddenly the avant-garde, the Russian avant-garde, was seen virtually exclusively to emerge from street signs. Well, that was a very important element, as 20 years before it had been seen exclusively from the Lubok. It has many sources, both native and foreign. And that is what makes this period so fascinating. The world of art did what it set out to do. It deprovincialized the art of the Russian, of going on in the Russian Empire. It made for this ongoing dialogue between the foreign and native, which produced this extraordinary synthesis. Which is unique to Ukrainian and Russian and artists in this period. When I looked at that wonderful work by Petritsky, which was the cover of it, of course there were all kinds of Ukrainian elements, but this part of the pair period, I think anyone looking at that yellow-black construction and that fish, I hope I'm not making this up, Georges Braque came to my mind instantly. I'm sure that is a painting, in other words, in which a very sophisticated dialogue is going on between Braque, whom he certainly could have known. Exter was the wonderful moderator for all these things by constant traveling, bringing home postcards, bringing home reproductions, et cetera, and showing them the Russians saw and Ukrainians saw Picasso for the first time in postcards that she brought back from her Paris trips. I mean, and in this case, I think she's brought back some others, which she's shown her pupil. But to me, that's an archetypical work of this period in which this kind of rich, subtle, sophisticated dialogue is going on between native and foreign elements, reaching a synthesis which is unique to Petritsky. In this case, we recognize this is not X, not Y. This is a work of Petritsky. That's the genius of these people, both Ukrainians and Russian, in this period. In other words, a dialogue is going on between East and West, Ukraine and Russian, the ancient art, Paleolithic art, et cetera. I mean, so many things are coming into this mix in this period, which is what makes it so fascinating, and which I would sort of utter a plea for let's not try to find its sources in one area, but recognize the multiple sources for the art which informs these artists and which produces this extraordinary thing. A dialogue which, as we know, which was brought to a forcible end by the Soviets in the 1930s, when one style, one cultural model, if you like, was imposed in a way that was as ruthless as anything, of course, the Tsarist government had done to Ukrainian culture in the 1930s. History, alas, repeated itself, and we're finally coming out of that, but it's a terrible stone which we still, which any of all of us dealing in this period have to deal with. So that's my only, you may agree or disagree, I'm not trying to stop discussion, but I think what I'm arguing for is complexity, really, in this period, because it's such a complex period.
Okay, we have a little time. Let's take maybe 10, 15 minutes to just open the floor for general discussion about any of the topics that have been brought up over these last 2 days.
Я передусім хотіла би подякувати дуже організаторам цієї конференції. І я би від'їхала звідси з відчуттям невиконаної своєї місії, якби я не сказала таку річ. Коли у нас йшла мова про розширення географії українського авангарду, я би дуже просила включити до цієї географії Прагу. У всякому разі українських художників, які зберігаються в чеських архівах і музеях. Ми говоримо приблизно про 1500 речей. І якщо б не було, наприклад, творів там, там є речі Княгиницької Душенко, яка абсолютно співпадає з цим періодом і про яку ми майже нічого не знаємо. Блискучого символіста, який підписувався і крапочка Сарден. І я тут, користуючись нагодою, хотіла би сказати «wanted». Я його розшукую. Я його розшукую, дані про цього автора, напевне, уже 6 років. І ніде нічого не знайшла, хоча знаю, навіть літераторів, фахівців в цій науці просила дізнатися про цього автора, тому що він співпрацював дуже тісно з молодомузівцем Василем Пачовським. Є прекрасні нарботовські речі в чеських, в праських колекціях. Можна було би говорити також про падалку, можна було би говорити про художника, який називався Юрій Вовк. Більше ніж 500 його речей є у чеських музеях в Празі. Через те я хотіла би, власне, оцим скористатися цією нагодою і вважаю, що без української Праги, без художників, які працювали там в міжвоєнний період, говорити про історію українського модернізму було би просто, ця розмова була би неповною. Дякую.
I would leave with a sense of unaccomplished mission if I did not say that if you are to talk about the expansion of the purvey of the geography of Ukrainian modernism, you are by all means to include in it Prague as a locus, a very important center where Ukrainian modernists created their works. It's enough to say that we're talking about a collection of about 1,500 exhibits created by a number of very prominent representatives of Ukrainian modernism, including such people as Knyaginitska Doshenko, the brilliant symbolist who signed by E with a little dot Sarden. For 6 years, I've been actively searching for documents, data relating to the author Vasil Pachovsky, and no?
They cooperate. He cooperated with.
Okay,
to him. Illustration to his books.
There are works by Narbut. There are about 500 artifacts, documents by Yuri Vovk in Prague.
Thank you.
Vladimir Dibrova.
Thank you. So what do we talk about when we talk about modernism? Are we talking about technicalities or artist intentions or some intertextuality? Or are we talking about something tribal like Arhipenko versus Arhipenka versus Arshipenko? You know, and probably the answer is that we are talking about everything else. And so we'd better know what we are looking for, because we're going to find it. And if we don't find it, we're going to invent it. And so I'd like to make a confession that the term, I was always used to be uneasy with the term Ukrainian modernism, in literature at least, because, and I'm not alone in this, I would say that the majority of the so-called Ukrainian, so-called intelligentsia, still believes that Ukrainian literature is some kind of minor subdivision of great Russian literature, something like this. And the only difference between them and me being that they don't know anything about literature, Ukrainian literature. I know a little bit. And that's why I think that they belong to totally different realms. They have different agendas and different purposes and aims. So Ukrainian literature definitely belongs to something like, starts with like Slovenian literature and ends at Belarusian, who have been always preoccupied with their national existence, felt threatened. And so they didn't have the luxury of being modernistic. They had to assert themselves. That was their priority, task number one. And history never allowed them this luxury. Now, why modernism? And there's a very good answer to this. If we look at, say, Apollinaire, and there's the answer to it. À la fin, tu es las de ce monde ancien. You're finally weary with this ancient world. Now, what is ancient world? This is, you know, Homer, Virgil, etc., etc. Now, for the majority of these writers, like peasant boys, they don't know anything about, you know, arma virumque. They were not taught this, and so their agenda was they just wanted to be a part of the world, and that's why even the works of Solomia Pavlichko and Tamara Hunderova didn't quite convince me, because their agenda was to try to prove that, yeah, we are with the big guys, we are there, we had our own, you know, modernism. On the other hand, the closer you look at Ukrainian literature, I mean, the best examples of it, the more you realize that it is there. And though with Tichina, I used to think that he was preoccupied with, like, he had this poem, "Horí, dívitsa sonce prámo v oči, bo stohne svět vidhenjiv nazdar, I žít sami vy budete nadvíči." So this is his polemics with the modernists. So he was preoccupied with "Oyupav zhivin z konya," the "Na Maidani bila tserkve," etc., etc., with the events that were taking place around him. But at the same time, it's amazing how, even if you look at, say, Plužnik, Kanyev, and "Pokirny naimit ya davno prikuti bazhanyam yisti shos drahivnits," etc., etc., this is exactly "Rhapsody on a Windy Night," or something similar to "Let us go then, you and I, when the evening spread out against the sky," etc., etc. So it's the same kind of sensibility. So what's interesting for me is how amazingly these things pop up at various parts of the world. Why? Because people underwent the same kind of trauma. I mean, with Eliot, there was the trauma of the Great War and you know, the crumbling of the civilization as he knew it. And for Ukrainians, there was the end of, you know, the revolution, civil war, and then the change of civilizational codes. And the way they reacted to it, it's amazing. It's just the same. It is, what's the term for it? You know, Zeitgeist or something like this. Yeah. And the same thing, you were talking about dialogue, precisely. So if you look at what happened like half a century after that, probably the biggest, the best, in my opinion, prose writer of the second part of the 20th century, Grigory Tytiunik. So he was definitely the pupil of Vasily Shukshin. And Shukshin was the pupil of Ernest Hemingway. And what's interesting for me as a reader would be to see how much this Hemingwayan tendency, trend, develops through Russia, in Ukraine, and what different forms it takes. So I think I'm totally with you in this, the dialogue complexity, and so I don't think that we should stress, we'll get over it, about this being Ukrainian or being Russian or being all this. You know, after all, for us readers, it's something that we come back to. We reread, we see once again and again and again, and we enjoy. And so I'm sure that there's plenty of that stuff in Ukrainian literature. The problem is that we haven't even started reading it and enjoying it.
Okay,
that's our biggest
thank
problem.
Thank you. Pat Grimstad? Thank you. We need a microphone?
Yes. I was wondering if you wanted a translation. No.
You've been here for a long time.
Okay. I speak not as an art historian or one who's very familiar with the art of this period, but I speak as an historian. And I'd like to continue, or at least put another level into John Malmstad's concern that we be more concerned with the complexity of things than attaching simple labels. And I'm also very concerned about the Ukrainian label. We've just heard from a literary historian about the modernism label, but I'm also concerned about the Ukrainian label, because I think that you also may want to consider art produced in Ukraine, but where do you mean in Ukraine? Do you mean during the period under consideration? We're concerned with the Russian Empire, the Austro-Hungarian Empire. We're concerned with post-revolutionary period of the Soviet Empire or changing Soviet Empire. We're concerned about Ukrainians in Poland as part of the new Polish Republic. And do we need to have a difference in Ukrainian in Western Ukraine, Eastern Ukraine, Jewish Ukraine? What about Odessa, which wasn't even part of Ukraine in that period? And then another level that I think is even more important is the concern, if we are concerned about the effect of location on art, the concern about in emigration, Ukrainians in emigration. Can we use the same Ukrainian label for Ukrainians in emigration? And or is there some dependence if there are an emigration in Prague, in Paris, or in Amsterdam? You know, I think that I like John's idea of complexity, but I'd like to throw in even a little more complexity in consideration of labels. Thank you.
That's why we introduced the term in context.
In context.
Other comments?
Here.
Yes, Hanya Krill.
Thank you. I don't have a specific comment on this conference, but I would like to take a moment to thank you for organizing such a wonderful event. I'm not a historian, not an art historian, and as a civilian, however, I would like to mention that one of the reasons why I enjoy going to these conferences is that I always learn a tremendous amount, and one of the things that I come away with is a desire to learn more, and certainly in this case, I have every intention of reading more, and I look forward to seeing much more material going into the future. One of the things I hope Professor Feiler permits me to do, as a representative of the Ukrainian Museum in New York, I would like to invite everyone to come down and see the Modernism exhibit, which was on display through the end of April. April 29th is when it closes. And next Saturday, if you'll permit me one more, we have invited Dr. Polenska, Dr. Mudrak, and Dr. Akinsha to speak on similar subjects, if not the very same ones, at the museum. Thank you.
Okay, we have time for maybe one more comment. Helena Hri.
I wanted to thank you for your concluding remarks and to say how much I appreciate them. In my when I began doing my investigation of the period, I also found that the world of art was really the closest that I found to be at the source for all the artists and their development. And I think that emphasis on the national. I would say that an interesting point is, with roots being very similar, and in fact, you know, I even have a chapter saying the international avant-garde through Russia or something like that into Ukraine. But I think an interesting point of departure is the whole Scythian and the Asian moment. A point of divergence, I'm sorry, because that is one thing that, despite the fact that people like Khvilyove did pick up on the whole Asiatic element, but I would say that that would be a sort of a real formation of something specifically Russian that would not be part of the Ukrainian moment. But I very much agree about the complexity, and in fact, the position of Literaturny Yarmarok and the battle that they waged against the party and for survival was the continuation of the complexity as opposed to the continual simplification of Soviet socialist realism. So I think that would be a very important theme to
end. Wonderful thing
yes.
About when you showed all those carousels was that in this one year, this was not a style evolving, all these things were going on at the same time. Mm-hmm. And it was a wonderful tribute to that journal that they did not take one narrow approach, which was so typical of journals of the time, to only have one group of people, writers, of artists, et cetera, represented, that they opened this up and made it really a yarmulke of ideas, styles, concerns. It was I learned so much about that, and so glad you resurrected it for me.
And if I may just say one more thing, I was very struck by what Dr. Lagutenko said. These things absolutely need to get published, and as soon as possible. So it's sort of a crying shame that the Ukrainian government, let's begin there, is not doing more to promote these studies, because it has a tremendous impact, as something like this conference shows. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, all good things must come to an end, but I think that we have really accomplished a tremendous amount over these last 2 days. I think that this conference did what John and I had hoped it would do. It really evolved into a large conversation. And the reason that we had briefer, or slightly less brief, presentations was to allow that to happen. And I'm very pleased that it did. In general, it created a number of beginnings that I think can really take us off in different directions to create investigations into that complexity that John was mentioning. There were a number of themes, of course, that we only hinted at, alluded to. Photography was, of course, one. Architecture is another. Film is yet another that we didn't really get a chance to talk about. And I think, there's every reason to think that perhaps in the future that we might have another gathering of perhaps a slightly different configuration of specialists to talk about those things. I was delighted to hear about the idea of putting on a conference about the constructivist theater. It seems to me this is precisely the kind of thing that would be very valuable, and I hope perhaps we can perhaps work together with the Ukrainian Museum to collaborate on something like that would bring a benefit to both of our institutions. I was delighted that literature was pulled into the discussion. That's always very, very important when we're talking about modernism and the whole business of sources. Again, I want to thank a number of people. First of all, I want to thank Greg Guroff, who unfortunately had to leave early, but who actually came to me, and then I to John, about the possibility of organizing a continuation of the exhibit that is now in New York. We were hoping to bring it here to the Boston area, and John and I visited a number of people trying to convince them, but alas, we weren't successful. But at the same time, I thought, why not have a conference to go with it? And so even though the idea of exhibiting this art in the Boston area didn't succeed, we nonetheless went ahead with the conference, and I'm delighted that we did. I want to thank John for that. I also want to thank, of course, Tamara Nari, without whom none of this could have taken place, and I want to give her a special round of applause. Also, Kate Kisselstein for all her work in preparing the program, Lubomir Hajda for all his editorial work, Kostya Bondarenko for his excellent information. And this really deserves a standing ovation, more the fantastic interpreting by Yuri Shevchuk. Even English into English, that was the Now we come to one of the actual tangible products of this conference, and that is the publication of our double issue of Harvard Ukrainian Studies. It's important to grab onto this moment when we're all thinking about what has been discussed over these past few days, and look at the text that we've produced and make the changes that we need to make right now. So what I am suggesting is that all final versions of your papers be turned in to Halina Hrin by June 15th. That gives you 2 months from now to finish them up, because we do want to get them out. Some of them will have to be translated. All of this is going to take time. That's number one. We will send you instructions again on the style sheet, instructions on how to send them, whether you want to send them electronically or in hard copy or on diskette. One other very important matter is reproductions. We would like to make very high quality reproductions of the art that you think is necessary to inform your papers. So please, if you have them, especially those in color, give them to us in the highest quality possible, and we will do our best to make sure that they are produced well in the actual copy. And I think that, those are the main things. And now the last thing I want to say is that if you all have time and interest, I would like to take you over as a group to see our new institute, to just show you around and show you what we look like. And then over there, we will also have in tubes, for those of you who wish to take them with you, unfolded versions of our poster in case you'd like to frame it or hang it up at home. But most of all, after all these thanks have been given, I would like to thank you for all that all of you have done to make this such a success. Bravo.